Let's talk.
Talk about.
Let's talk to Linnaeus.
Linnaeus, my man.
You like him?
Oh, he's the best. The best. Actually, I was just in a big sort of debate with that. I did a review of a Latin article about what the point of learning Latin is. My take was as broad as possible. We want people to try to read Linnaeus.
Yeah.
Do math, do science, do all kinds of other things. Religion.
Yeah.
Other people just want Caesar and Cicero, Virgil.
Right.
The classical authors. And Linnaeus and Latin are very different. So it's...
Yeah.
You sort of have to do very different things in order to be good at
Well, if we want to rename everything in the mechanical and normal room, you kind of have to have a little bit of an ego.
Yeah, I mean, his method of identifying plants by the parts of the flower is still very effective, though it's not the basic method now. But what's fabulous about it is that you can use it in the field.
Right.
And whereas now, there's a whole revolution in taxonomy is based on DNA and genetics.
Right.
So you can't use that stuff in the field, like you don't know.
You can't do DNA. But before Linnaeus, it was things were just named in a more haphazard way. Based on some
superficial characteristics. And that's still.
Parameters amongst each quality, and then interchanging those elements to create new elements which work with the species but which aren't modeling a thing that
So the idea of a plant as a machine, right? You input light, you input water, you input nutrients in the soil, and you get a certain result, a certain formal result. Like that's sort of not a way that people traditionally use plants. Inspiration is very much a new thing. And it's cool.
It's gaining a deeper understanding.
It's lineage in time.
And
the way that it functions as DNA, in other words, as a machine.
Yeah.
What it's computer programmed for, as opposed to just what its outside form.
Right.
And so that's the thing, is that when you treat mushrooms not only as a form, but as something that has potential human effects.
Right.
Okay. Attempting to recreate that within the gallery, right?
Yeah.
You know, to create a sort of psychedelic experience within there.
Yeah.
You would be looking at it more in terms of its blueprints.
But it's a psychedelic experience based on only the banal, the mosaic, the actual facts of the species, rather than any kind of exaggeration of the that's true. So you've read Lucretius in the original Latin? Yeah.
So it's
hard because because of the way. I mean, you understand the words, but the way that
Latin has this is the problem with Latin's grammar too. Like Latin, unlike Greek, Greek has a horrible number of words in the lexicon, which I am among it. But Latin has a small number of words. There's much more ambiguity in terms of the way they're used.
Context.
Yes, and so for someone like Lucretius, who's attempting to take Greek atomic theory, bring it over into Latin verse, right? So he had to choose words that also fit the dactylic hexameter.
Right.
Which is absurd, right?
Even greater challenge.
And so there are these terms, like in Latin, silva, it means a forest, right? Like Pennsylvania, Pennswood, the woods. But that word is also used to mean the raw material of anything.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay, and so like anything that you work with before you start doing work to it, before you put form on it, is silva.
Oh.
Right? But that's a jump in meaning.
Those are polar, it's different.
But you can understand, for people who live in a temperate zone, forest is the raw materials that you would buy.
Yeah,
okay.
Right.
Most of the things you make come from the forest.
Yeah.
Right. So that's silva, right? Raw material.
Yeah.
But as you're reading it, you're like, well, what is it though? And then all of a sudden, like, you know, some creator or maybe just a chance association of atoms impressed a form upon the forest.
Right.
And you're like, it's impressed a form upon raw material. Right.
Right.
And it's like if it's the same word used for both, which just
into plants.
Into plants.
Yeah.
Into, you know, and there are they're not just nettles, but false nettles, which look a lot like them.
Right.
And then they're similar, but they're plants which...
But they're completely different species.
Mm-hmm. And that kind of, that sort of system, the fact that nature itself seems to keep people lying.
Right.
It makes our own lying, puts our own lying into the context.
Right.
I think it's very, very neat.
Well, there's several different functions for deception.
Mm-hmm.
There's deception to protect oneself.
By
camouflage.
Yeah, give an okay to that.
And there's deception in order to be a better predator,
mm-hmm.
by hiding.
Mm-hmm.
So
camouflage.
Mm-hmm. Your prey does not see you.
What would deception for the sake of reproduction? You know, so like that, you know, the fact that plants can have kind of parts which will mimic, they say, the reproductive parts of other insects, which will attract these insects, bring them into the flower where they're dusted with pollen, and they go off, disappointed.
Right.
They go to the next one and are tricked again to do the same thing.
Right.
So serving the
looking
need
at
the reproduction of the plant.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the, I guess, the ethical question would be more heavily weighted upon the deception when it's actually to kill someone.
Right.
Because the guy, the insect that is attracted to the fake plant vagina will not be hurt by
it. Easy, unethical to begin with. Right, but he deserves everything he's done. Yeah,
but the deception to prey.
The fact that a pitcher plant, right, will appear to offer pollen and nectar to an insect, but the point is to trap it inside.
Yeah,
it's not for the sake of reproduction; it's for the sake of luring other insects in to digest them.
Well, there's the fungus that emits the smell of rotting meat. In order to attract the fly, and then the spores are in the kind of glutinous covering on this stinky glutinous covering on this mushroom. But again, not much harm